Dr. Uhen is here tonight to share a more serious passion for and research in the evolution of whales. He is an assistant professor in the Department of Atmospheric, Oceanic, and Earth Sciences at George Mason, that's a mouthful, in Fairfax, Virginia. And after receiving a BS in geology with a minor in biology from the University of Wisconsin, Oshkosh, he continued his study in geology at the University of Michigan in Ann Arbor, receiving an MS and later a PhD. Among other positions, he served on staffs on the staffs of the Alabama Museum of Natural History as curator of paleontology, and at the Cranbrook Institute of Science as head of research and collections and as curator of paleontology and zoology. Much of his research has centered on the origin and evolution of cetaceans and paleodiversity. In addition to receiving many grants, conducting on-site research all around the world, writing articles for numerous scholarly publications, he's also demonstrated his ability to share his research with those of us like me who are a little less specialized in our knowledge through avenues like National Public Radio's All Things Considered and as an advisor on the BBC Discovery Channel's Walking with Beasts and Chased by Dinosaurs. So he brings to us both vast amount of research as well as an ability to share that information with the public. Because we do have kind of a diverse audience this evening, Dr. Uhen is going to do his formal presentation, have a brief question and answer time, and then if you need to leave, you can feel free to do that, but if you have more particular questions, more specialized things that you're interested in, you'd like to talk to him a little bit more, there'll be time for that kind of interchange, a little more detailed question and answer time. And without taking any more of his time, I want to introduce Dr. Mark Uhen and let him come and put our whale fossil into the bigger picture of whale evolution.
Thank you very much. I guess the first thing I should ask is, can you all hear me? Good? In the back? Yeah, all right. So thanks to Susan and the museum for inviting me down. I've had a great time since I've been here. And I'm glad I made it with the weather you had yesterday. It was a little dicey there, but here I am. And I am going to share with you my passion for these early whales and where they came from, and hopefully put the fossil whale that you guys have here in a bigger context. And we're going to see where whales came from, how your whale evolved, and then where they went from there to understand the whales, dolphins, and porpoises that are around today. So, this to work. Okay, so whales are part of this group called the cetacea, and whales are mammals. So they're mammals like you and me, and that means they nurse their young. They do have a little bit of hair here and there, but they're mostly hairless. They're warm-blooded, so they have all the characteristics of mammals, but they're really unusual in that they live in the water. Most mammals and mammals primitively lived on land, so they had to undergo a transition from living on land to living in the ocean. And that's what we're going to talk about today. So this group of modern whales are called the Neocoelacanthi. That just means new whales in Latin. And we scientists like to put Latin names on everything. So I'll try to explain what most of them mean. And if you're like, hey, you forgot, just stick your hand up and I'll remember. So one group, shown here in blue, are the Mysticeti. They're the big, the really big, baleen-bearing whales. So these guys lack teeth today. But as we'll see, some of their fossil relatives have teeth. And they have this stuff called baleen that hangs down from the roof of their mouth, which you can see right here. See the little fringy stuff? It's made of keratin, like your fingernails and your hair. So it's stiff and fibrous, but flexible. And they use that to filter things from the water, which they then eat. And they're much less diverse than the other group of modern cetaceans. There's only 7 living genera and about 66 fossil genera, although we're discovering more all the time. The other group of living whales are the Odontici, and those guys, that means toothed whale, and these guys, some of them don't have teeth, some have like one tooth, and some have a whole bunch. It's like killer whales and dolphins have a whole lot of simple pig-like teeth. So these are the toothed whales, and these guys are specialized in feeding on individual prey items, which they don't chew. Like, mammals are very specialized chewing machines, but these guys stop chewing. They basically just take a prey item and they swallow it whole. But what's really special about them is they use this feature called echolocation, where they send out high-frequency sounds, and then listen for the echoes to find their prey, and they actually sense their entire environment using echolocation. So that's a specialization that modern odontocetes have. And so we'll come back to these, so keep that in your head, we'll come back to them. But there's also another group called the archaeocetes. And these guys, that word means ancient whales. And the archaeocetes are encompass the transition from terrestrial animals all the way up to fully aquatic animals. And it is these ancient whales that I'm going to spend most time talking about, because they are the ones that are ancestral to the two modern groups that we have that I just talked about. So there are no living archaeocetes, although their descendants are still with us in the living odontocetes and mysticetes. And this number keeps going up as we describe more and more of these things. And they exist from the early Eocene to the late Oligocene. And I'll show you what that means in terms of time in just a minute. But this is one I'm very fond of, and you're gonna hear this word again and again, Dorudon, which is one of the very first fully aquatic whales. Okay, so if there's one thing I want you to remember from this lecture, this is it. It's that, remember I said whales are mammals, but we know what terrestrial mammals they're most closely related to. And that is, whales are artiodactyls. And you're like, what's an artiodactyl? You know them. Artiodactyls are the even-toed ungulates. And ungulates are just hooved mammals. So cows, goats, giraffes, pigs, hippos, sheep, all artiodactyls. And whales are not just closely related to this group. The whales are shown down here, just right there in blue. But all these guys, and they're hippos, all these things are nested within this larger group, which are artiodactyls. So they're not just related to them, they are artiodactyls. And I will show you a little bit of the evidence that has come out in the last 10 to 15 years, which really prove this hypothesis that whales are part of this group. Okay, so here is an example of a fossil animal, which is an artiodactyl, that we think is closely related to whales. And it's in this group called the Rauelidae. It's named after this guy Rau, who is an Indian. He lived in India. And his collection of fossils is where the first Rauelids were described from. And here's a picture of some of the fossils. Here's a skull. There's some long bones, and these are cross sections of these bones. We cut them in half to look at the inside. And this is sort of a map of the skeleton. So the stippled areas are bits we don't have, and the white areas are ones we do have. So we have a lot of this animal. And if you just look at the head and look at the teeth, they look just like other artiodactyls at the time. There's nothing really special about them. And so you guys are familiar with the artiodactyls that I told you about, like what's in this group. What do artiodactyls eat today? Cows and sheep. They eat plants, right? Well, these have plant-eating teeth. They look like other plant eaters at the time. But do whales eat plants today? Nope. They eat marine meat of some sort. Krill is sort of a meat source. Fish, squid, that sort of thing. So they underwent not just this transition from living on land to living in the water, but they also made a huge dietary shift from eating plants to eating other marine meat sources. And this guy has typical plant-eating teeth, but there are things about it which suggest that it lived in the water. And if you look at these long bones, do you see how thick this bone is? All this white here is bone, and that's the space in the center of the bone. Now, the typical things that live on land have a very big space inside, and they don't have this thick layer of bone. But you tend to see that in things that spend time in the water. It kind of weights them down, keeps them from floating away. And these guys also have, see this sort of, looks like a sort of nubbin or like a little melon or something sitting on the bottom of their head there? Those are these things called the auditory bulli, which are sort of a covering for the ear. And they're very specialized in whales to help them hear underwater. And this otherwise terrestrial looking animal has these thickened bones and whale ears. And so it suggested to the guy who described them, this guy Hans Tedesen, that maybe they were hanging out in the water. And I would suggest that probably are feeding in the water. And if you think about it, you know, we said that artiodactyls eat plants, but there's one group of artiodactyls in particular that tends to have a really varied diet, like pigs. Pigs really eat anything. And so I envision these guys having a more pig-like omnivorous diet, and then they become more and more specialized on eating aquatic prey as they spend more and more time in the water. So these are the very tentatively semi-aquatic artiodactyls, the robinids. So now the earliest, I'm going to describe the evolution of whales in three phases. So first we're going to cover this transition from terrestrial to aquatic, which is going to take up a lot of time. And then we're going to look at the diversification of those two groups of modern whales, the mysticetes and odontocetes. And then we'll try to figure out where the modern mysticetes and odontocetes came from this early burst of diversification. So we're going to start here and look at the very earliest whales and see how they became fully aquatic. Okay, so to tell this tale, I have to set the stage, right? I can't, you know, the world was a different place when this was happening. So this time period is the early Eocene, which is about 50 million years ago. And this is a world map. And you can recognize the continents. They're all pretty much where they are today, with a couple of glaring exceptions. What's a biggie? What's out of place? India. India is in the middle of the Indian Ocean, and it hasn't met Asia yet. So if you didn't know this, India used to be part of a big supercontinent down here that included South America, Africa, India, Australia, and Antarctica, and for some time has been sailing across the ocean and has yet to collide with Asia. So it's just starting to. It's just starting to encounter Asia up here. Other things are that North America and South America aren't quite connected, and South America and Antarctica are, so no water can flow here, and Australia is also connected to Antarctica. And you're like, eh, what's the big deal? But here's the big deal. Today, there's a current that goes around and around Antarctica called the Circumantarctic Current. And if you think about the way sunlight hits the Earth, where does most of the solar energy hit the planet? The equator, okay? And so today what happens is, or in this world what happens is, the sunlight hits the equator, warms the oceans, and it transports the warmth north and south. It gets moved by ocean and air currents to the north and to the south. And here it gets all the way to Antarctica and keeps it warm. And in the early Eocene, there was no permanent ice on the planet. So there's no glaciers at the North Pole, no glaciers at the South Pole. There are probably some glaciers on high mountains, but that's it. So the world was warmer, and there was a less of a temperature gradient between the poles and the equator. So it was a pretty different planet, not just with the continents in different places, but notice I put palm trees all over to indicate that it's basically warm-ish everywhere. That will become relevant in a little bit, so we'll come back to that. Okay, so this is the phase one of whale evolution. In this context, this is when it happens. And these are two reconstructions of the exact same animal called Pachycetus. And it's called Pachycetus because they found it in Pakistan. So cleverly they call it Pachycetus, the Pakistan whale. And these are two reconstructions by my former PhD advisor and this guy's former PhD advisor. And Hans thinks it's more terrestrial, and Hans Tedesen and Phil Gingrich thinks it's more aquatic. And so basically they're the same animal. It's just one swimming and one's walking. And if you look at them really closely, there's not very much different between the two reconstructions. But what is interesting about it is that, unlike the Rauwellids, it has a really long face. This is something that we see in lots of animals that feed in the water. Things like crocodiles, or gharials, or gars, or whales, like dolphins, have a long snout, and they use it to sort of pinch and grab food. And that's what we see here, is that it's a long face. And their teeth get pulled out along with them. So that's one difference between them and the terrestrial Rauwellids. Okay, I give up. So here's the skull of Pachycetus, And it has the whale ears, the big auditory bulla that I told you about. And here's the jaw. You can see the front teeth are pulled out into this little row. In a terrestrial mammal, they'd be in a little arc across the front. And here's what we know of Pachycetus. We have got the skull, the jaw, the ears, a lot of the vertebrae, hind limbs, and forelimbs. We know a lot about this animal. It could clearly walk around on land very easily. And it could also, I'm sure, swim, as you can toss any mammal in the water and it will swim. So another group of whales that show up in Pakistan early on is this group called the Ambulocetidae. And this means the walking whales. And not that others didn't walk, but these guys are known for it. And these are bigger. Pakistan is a pretty small animal. These are bigger. It's got a big head and very robust hind limbs. It's got big hind limbs. Do whales have hind limbs today? Pretty much no. They have a little stick of bone, I'll show you, but they pretty much don't have hind limbs. But these guys do because their ancestors had hind limbs. And they use them for locomotion. So they could walk around on land and use them for propulsion in the water. Whales are also restricted to India and Pakistan. So that area where India is beginning to collide with Asia still has ocean in there, and that's where these whales live. The earliest whales lived in that little bit of ocean between India and Pakistan, or India and Asia. Okay, so we're still making this transition from terrestrial to aquatic, but we're advancing about 5 million years into the future. And things have changed a little. Notice that India is even closer to Asia. But we still have these blockages down here. Antarctica is still connected to South America and Australia. So we still have this tropical ecosystem or warmer ecosystem everywhere. And notice that the little dots all over the place, those are all the different kinds of whales. Now they're outside of India and Pakistan. They're still there. We find them in Egypt, Europe, North America, South America, West Africa, even down here, which is New Zealand. It looked like New Zealand, trust me. And so whales have left their place of origin, Indo-Pakistan, and have spread out across the planet. And they're also beginning to diversify for the first time. We're getting lots of different kinds of whales. And this group that first makes it out of India and Pakistan is called the Proto-Cetidae. Proto means first, and when they were named, Proto-Cetus was the earliest whale. No longer the earliest whale, but still the name stuck. And this is an animal called Rhodocetus from Pakistan, described by Phil Gingrich. And we have a really complete skeleton of this animal. The only thing we're missing is this hatched area of the tail back here, which is kind of a shame because whale tails are very interesting. It would be nice to have it, but this one specimen didn't have it. So this is a reconstruction of Rhodocetus based on the skeleton. Notice it still has all four limbs, although the hind limbs are starting to get a little smaller. They're relatively smaller than those in Pachycetus and Ambulocetus, so they're a little smaller. But they can still walk around on land, and they could also use their forelimbs and hind limbs for locomotion in the water. And these guys, like I said, are the first ones to get across Africa and into North America and even to South America. And this is some of the actual bones of Rhodocetus from two different specimens. So this is one specimen, and this is another specimen, but they're the same genus. So here's the skull, lower jaw, the pelvis, and femur. These are the hands and feet in a jacket. When we take things out of the field, we can take them in a blob of rock and wrap it up in plaster and burlap, so we can take it back to the laboratory and extract the bones very carefully. And that's what you see here. And I show you this to show that all these bones, we know exactly how they relate to one another because they were preserved that way. It's like the animal just died right there. It just got buried in sediment. We could just extract it. So here's the hand with the wrist and the fingers. This is the ankle and foot. And this paper and this fossil was what really convinced most scientists that whales are artiodactyls. And the reason is this bone right here, that one, I think I have a slide that shows this more close up. I hope so. I don't. I think I have to talk about it here. So that bone is called the astragalus. And most mammals have one, all mammals have one basically. But artiodactyls have a very, very specialized one that looks like a pulley shape on the proximal end, the end closest to your knee, and the distal end. It shows this little pulley shape here and a pulley shape here. And only artiodactyls have that. No other mammal has anything like that. And here it is, the first time we discovered one in a whale, and they have an artiodactyl ankle. And so that right there really convinced people. And in addition to that, when people have looked at the genetics of these things, the genes too say that they're not just artiodactyls, but most closely related to hippos. And so both the fossils and the molecules are telling us the same story. And so when all this data points in the same direction, most people decided that, yep, indeed, whales are artiodactyls. Okay, so here's the first ones to get to North America. So if you look up here, these are different genus names, and the dots represent things we can't identify the genus, but they're protocetids. You can see they're scattered everywhere from New Jersey, North Carolina, South Carolina, Georgia, we're gonna come back to that, into Alabama, Mississippi, Louisiana, and Texas. So basically anywhere where we find Middle Eocene rocks, which are these gray things, they do exist in Georgia, it's in Chopin's map, we find these whales. And this was from a paper I just wrote where I described some from New Jersey, which is about as far north as rocks of this age actually even exist in North America. And this is as far south as they go in North America, right there. So let's zoom in on, so this shows two different areas of the southeast US, the Gulf Coast and the East Coast. And these are different rock units. And here's Georgia in red. And when I look down here, there, that little triangle represents the earliest whale known in Georgia, perhaps North America. There's also one over here. These guys are almost equally old in South America, or sorry, South Carolina, and over here in Louisiana and Alabama. But then there's some later ones. So we're gonna look at that one right here, which is Middle Eocene. It's called Georgia Cetus. If you've never seen this, it's at Georgia Southern in their museum in, I'm sorry, where is it again? Zanesburg. I always forget the town. I've been there. And this is the display, and this is a reconstruction that I had done for a paper I wrote a few years ago on Georgia Cetus. And what's really interesting about Georgia Cetus is that not only is it one of the earliest whales in North America, but it also has a big pelvis. Unfortunately, we don't have any of this hiding material. That's reconstructed, but we do have the pelvis. And what's weird about it, I think I have a picture of the pelvis, there it is that it looks like this big pelvis was not attached to the vertebral column. Now, if you think about how your legs work, your leg bones connected to the hip bone, this, and then your hip is actually connected to your vertebral column. Think about if your hip wasn't connected to your vertebral column, what would happen? You'd just fall apart, it'd turn into mush, right? Your limbs would not function. And so, what good is a big hind limb if it's not attached to your vertebral column? Well, I suggested that what these guys did was they took those big hind legs and stuck them out behind them, and then moved their vertebral column up and down in the water, pushing their limbs through the water. So they couldn't bear weight, but they could function as what we call hydrofoil. They're what pushes the water and moves them forward. Now today, whales don't have hind legs, so what do they use as a hydrofoil to push them through the water? Their tail, right? They have this cool triangle thing on the end of their tail called the flukes that they push through the water to move them. Well, I think these guys did the same thing, but instead of the flukes, they used their legs. And only later, I'll show you some evidence of when the flukes evolved in these guys. Okay, so there's Georgia Cetus. All right, so now we're up to the late Eocene. This is the end of the transition from terrestrial to aquatic. So this is the last bit of that. And again, things are about the same, but Indy keeps moving north, and you can't really see it, but these ports are about to open up. So in the next map I show you, that's gonna change. But it's still warm and equable everywhere, but now we got these yellow dots. Notice they're all the same color. That means all the earlier whales have gone extinct. And now we only have the yellow guys, which are called the basilosaurids. We're gonna spend a lot of time on them because that's why we're here. And so notice we have basilosaurids basically everywhere. And we have a lot of them from North America and a lot of them from Egypt. So this is my favorite of all the basilosaurids. It's called Dorudon. and I wrote my doctoral dissertation on it many years ago. And it's best known from Egypt. And this is a skeleton that was made as a composite drawing from all the different specimens that we collected in Egypt. And we have basically every bit of the skeleton represented by one or many fossils. And there are some really significant differences between these guys and the ones I've been showing you. So first off, where are the hind limbs? They're not gone. This little smudge, you have your glasses, you can't see, that little smudge is the hind limbs. They still have them, but they're super teeny and they're definitely disconnected from the vertebral. Other things that are different is they got a whole lot more vertebrae in this region. There's more thoracic, the ones with ribs, and there's more lumbar vertebrae. So they get a much longer back. And as you'll see, their forelimbs are different, the tails are different, there's differences in the skull and teeth. And all these things pile up to suggest that bathysaurids are the earliest fully aquatic whales, ones that clearly couldn't come out of land anymore. So here's the skull. I don't know what these stupid lines are, but here's the skull in dorsal view and ventral view. And there's that auditory bulla, that specialized ear. The ears are actually getting even more specialized for underwater hearing in bathysaurids. I don't want to go into the details, but they could hear pretty darn well underwater. And if you look at them from the side, see these teeth? They got little sort of jiggy-jag things on them that go up and down, and they look like triangles with little bumps all over them. Those little bumps are new. They didn't appear in any of the earlier whales, but they show up in bathysaurids. And as you'll see, they actually are still there in the earliest mysticetes and odontocetes. So keep an eye on those. Other things, see this notch here? If you look, that notch is this hole in the dorsal view. That's, what is that? What are you telling me that?
Nose?
It's the nose. It's the nares, where the actual hole in the skull for the nose is. And in a typical terrestrial mammal, like think about your dog, where's the nose on your dog? It's right up here, tip of the snout, right? Well, in whales, it's actually way up on top of their head, modern whales. And in these guys, it's halfway in between. So it started out here, moved back, and the modern whale is way up here. So it's sort of halfway between the modern whale and the really ancient whales. Okay, more stuff about Dorudon. Remember I said whales are mammals, right? So how many sets of teeth do mammals have in their life? Two. We're mammals, we have two. We have baby teeth, we got adult teeth. Well, strangely enough, mysticetes don't have teeth, so it doesn't apply to them. But the odontocetes, the toothed whales and dolphins of today, only represent one set of teeth, ever. And we don't know what they are. We don't know whether they're baby teeth or adult teeth. Nobody really knows. But these guys are more like typical terrestrial mammals in that they erupt two sets of teeth. And this is my favorite fossil ever. And this is the upper jaw, the maxilla, this over here, of a Dorudon from Egypt. And if you look, there's this tooth that does not, it's not like as high as the rest. And look at that one. What's going on there? What's going on there? They're not just baby teeth. Actually, these are baby teeth. This, and this is baby tooth. And that is the last baby tooth popping into place. And this is actually the first adult tooth coming in behind those others. So by looking at all these, we have this great wealth of specimens from Egypt where they died when they were babies and adults and all different ages. So we can work out how they grew and developed as organisms. So this one died pretty close to birth, not long after it got born. And I can work out the entire dental eruption sequence, like the sequence of teeth erupting, which can tell you about how fast they grow up. Whales tend to grow up very slowly. They mature very slowly. Does that remind you of any other mammals you know? Us? Yep. And wouldn't you know, if you look at whale brains today, they have really, really big brains relative to their body size, just like us. It may have something to do with that. These guys grew up moderately quickly, but slower than other mammals of their age. And we also have bones of their ear. Did you know there's a little chain of bones that connect your ear, your eardrum into your inner ear? And that's what these are. And they're very dense in whales, and these bones are very dense. And this is actually the cochlea, which is a space inside a bone in your ear. And that space is filled with fluid and little hair cells, and when the fluid moves, the hair cells move, and that creates a nervous impulse that goes in your brain, which we perceive as sound. And if you look at the anatomy of their cochlea, you can determine the frequencies that these whales could hear. And modern toothed whales use this echolocation I told you about. It's a very high frequency system. And I can tell you by looking at the cochlea that these guys couldn't do that. They could not perceive high frequency sound. It's necessary for echolocation. So it had to evolve later. And these guys hear more like modern mysticetes, the baleen whales, which don't echolocate. So we know a lot about Dorudon and its relatives. Now, remember how I told you I was going to show you evidence that the tail fluke evolved? Well, here it is. Look at this one. If you look at this, this is a picture of the end of the vertebral column from a modern dolphin, Spinella, Spinella and spotted dolphins. And notice there's this huge shape change. They get narrower and narrower and narrower. All of a sudden they get really flat and wide and a little wider, and then they get narrower and narrower. And that shape change right here between this shape vertebra and that shape vertebra, guess what happens there in the living animal? That's where the flukes stay, right there. And they get flat in the flat part of the fluke. Crazy, right? So the bones actually go up the middle part of the fluke, and then the rest of it's all just skin. Well, that doesn't preserve so well as a fossil, but the bones do. If you look in Dorudon, it's not exactly the same, but it's pretty close. It gets narrower and narrower, and they get wide, just like up here. And so it looks like they have a fluke too. And so we can say that, yes, this animal had a fluke and probably inserted right about here. Yay. So now we have modern whale locomotion in these first fully aquatic whales. That's not a coincidence. If you look over here, this is what we have of the hind limb of Dorudon. This is a piece of the femur. That's what's left of the astragalus. It doesn't look very artiodactyl-like, but it's this little nubbin. But that, do you know what that bone is? A little football? You've never seen one of these, you'll never see one again. That's the kneecap. That's the patella of the whale. Your kneecap looks just like that, almost just like that. There you go, kneecap of a whale. And this is the pelvis of a related animal from South Carolina called Chrysocetus. And there's a little ball joint for where the femur would articulate. We don't have that from this animal, but these are very closely related, so that's probably what it looked like, something like that. Okay, so here's where they are in North America. Again, this is a geologic map, so you can see the different bands of color represent different ages, which are represented over here. And if you look, the different colors represent different animals. And you can see, again, all the way from Virginia down through the Carolinas into Florida and all the way over into Louisiana. None from Texas. I don't know why. We should have them from Texas, but no one's done any there yet. They're really common in Alabama and Mississippi. Maybe not so much over here. The dots are, there's dots upon dots upon dots. You can't quite see how many there are. Here they're a little more Spartan. Here's you guys. You're in Georgia. And yours is from there. That little pink thing. So, your animal that you have hanging outside has been identified previously as Zygorhiza. And this is, these pictures are all from this book written by Remington Kellogg, sort of the godfather of fossil whaleology. And he worked at Smithsonian. And most of the fossils he had there came from Alabama and Mississippi. And he described Zygorhiza. This is the skull, it looks a lot like Dorudon. So they're really similar animals. They're not super duper different. But if you look at the skeleton, it's all overall more lightly built. It's a little more, what we say, gracile, where Dorudon is a little more robust. It's like thicker and bigger. So Dorudon's a little bigger, and the bones are all a little thicker, and Zygorhiza has these ribs on the teeth, and particularly in the back of the teeth, has these little ridges with little bumps all over them. And they're really quite distinct. And Zygorhiza has them, and Dorudon does not have them. And this is yours. And the question is it Zygorhiza, or is it Dorudon? And I did a study a couple years ago where I tried to look at these things, and it appeared to me that Zygorhiza was mainly known from the Gulf Coast states, so Louisiana, Mississippi, and Alabama, and that Dorudon, the original Dorudon, was actually named from South Carolina. I looked at all the specimens from the Carolina mines here in Georgia, and most of those specimens are strange. They're very different from yours, because this is most of the skeleton. And virtually every other specimen from these Kaolin mines is a single bone or a single tooth. And so it's kind of hard to characterize when you got one bone and one tooth. but all the teeth that are distinctive look like Dorudon. And so I've never been able to see your specimen until today. And these photographs are literally hot off my camera because I took them this morning. And here's the jaw. The thing to know about the specimen is that this skull is not from the specimen. It's actually a cast of one from Smithsonian, which is one of the ones Kellogg described, because this specimen doesn't have a skull. And so don't look at the skull, because that is Zygorhiza, but we're only looking at the lower jaw. And if you look carefully at the teeth, which I did, I'm going to show you some pictures. So these are the front teeth. So that's the front of the jaw. So we're going to move back a little bit more. That's the sort of intermediate teeth. That's the canine, first premolar, second premolar, and then moving back, second premolar, third premolar, fourth premolar, and the three molars. Those, my friends, are the teeth of Dorudon, not the teeth of Zygorhiza. And if you look at the skeleton, it's more robustly built, just like Dorudon, not Zygorhiza. And since all the other specimens from Georgia are pretty Dorudon, this one has all the characteristics of Dorudon, although the real clincher is those upper teeth, the upper premolars. Really love to see them, but you don't have them. But everything that you have, all the clues, suggest that this animal is really Dorudon, not Zygorhiza. Which I think is really exciting, because yes, you might have to change a couple of exhibit labels, but now you have a new story to tell. You get to tell the story that now you have Dorudon here in Georgia instead of Zygorhiza. Might we find some Zygorhiza in the future? Maybe. But right now, I think it's a separation that's ecological, because back in the Eocene, when these guys lived, there was a proto-Mississippi River dumping sediment into the Gulf Coast, and it made the water more muddy and cloudy. Whereas on the East Coast, we don't see that. The water's cleaner. And so I think Dorudon, like this cleaner, fresher water that you had here in Georgia and points north, and maybe Florida, I don't know, Florida's still kind of a mystery. But the Gulf states had Zygorhiza, and I think they just separated ecologically. And so you're on the East Coast side here in the kaolin mines in Georgia. So there you go. I think we have Dorudon instead of Zygorhiza. But we decided that you can still call it Ziggy, but it's Ziggy the Dorudon, not Ziggy the Dorudon. Because the name is just a name. All right. So now we've got fully aquatic whales. So now the world is changing dramatically. You see the icebergs? Yep, that's why. Here's what happened. These connections between South America and Antarctica and Australia and Antarctica finally break. And water starts to swirl around Antarctica in the circum-Antarctic current. And immediately, in a geologic sense, like within thousands of years, tens of thousands of years, we get ice growth in Antarctica. And so Antarctica freezes over, and it has an effect on the North Pole too. So you get colder water at the poles and a much steeper temperature gradient between the poles and the equator. Basically, modern ocean circulation gets established at the Oligocene, this time about 28 million years ago. And so the world changed dramatically, and for the most part, basalsaurids and all the rest of the archaeocenes disappear from the planet. And we get the evolution of the modern groups of mysticetes and odontocetes, which are now represented by these red and blue dots, and you see them here and there. And there's not a whole lot of fossils from this time period, but the ones we have are virtually all these modern groups of whales. And I think it has to do with the way they feed. And it's really different from the way archaeocenes feed, and I think that was set up by this change in oceanic circulation. So now I have to start telling you two stories, because we have two different groups of whales. So first thing, I'm gonna tell you the story of mysticetes, then I'll come back and we'll tell you the story of the odontocetes. So mysticetes, here's Zygorhiza, or you could throw it down there, it's just a representative basalsaurid archaeocete, as the closest relative to the modern whale. So here's Zygorhiza, here are the toothed whales, and then these things are the earliest mysticetes. And the ones in the yellow box are all toothed mysticetes. And you may be saying, wait a minute, didn't he tell us that mysticetes had baleen, not teeth? Well, that's true today, but remember, they evolved from things with teeth. So the earliest ones still had teeth, and only later did they lose them and as they grow baleen. And in fact, all these guys had really wacky looking skulls and strange teeth, and they fed in very unusual ways that we wouldn't really recognize as a mysticete. And only later did they evolve baleen in this group over here. So let's take a look at some of those early two strange mysticetes. The very earliest one is from right at the boundary between the Eocene and the Oligocene, and it was found on Seymour Island in Antarctica, which is a pretty desolate place. I've never been, I'd love to go, but it was discovered by some guys who was doing a polar expedition, and they brought back a couple of teeth in a jaw and an endocast of the brain, so the sediment that had filled up the brain cavity, and that was it. But later, somebody went back and found more of the skeleton, so this reconstruction is pretty accurate based on what we know of the skeleton. And it looks pretty much like an archaeocene. This is the tooth right here. Is that look familiar? Sort of triangular shape that bumps up to one side and down the other. Right? I told you to keep track of those little cusp-y things. Here they are in the earliest mysticete. But there are some features of the skull which suggest that it is an early mysticete. And this is a tooth of a leopard seal. And what these and their relatives, the crab-eater seals, do with those teeth is they take a mouthful of seawater and krill, and they close their mouth, and they squirt the water out between their teeth. It comes out between these cusps, and the krill stays inside. So it may be that the earliest mysticetes were filter feeding with teeth like that, but they were doing it with their teeth, not with baleen. Okay, so they may have adopted this behavior first, and then evolve the structure to do it later. So here's some other weird guys. This one's called James Eusebius. And if someone had handed me that skull and said, what is this? I'd be like, I don't know, sea lion? Because just at first glance, it looks really like a sea lion skull. But it's got a bunch of little teeth with little cusps, and it's got these big eyes. And it's really short and really three-dimensional, whereas mysticete skulls today are often very flat, and they have their teeth. So this is a very small animal from the late Oligocene of Australia. And I don't know what it was doing. This Eric Fitzgerald, the guy who described it, thinks it was, it could have been sediment feeding, it could have been going after schools of fish, more like a sea lion would do. We don't know. But it's one of the earliest mysticetes that still retain teeth. And a little bit later, these guys evolved. They're called the Ediacetidae. They're best known across the North Pacific, so we have them in places like Oregon, Washington, and Japan, so all across the North Pacific. And they still have teeth, but the teeth are really small. And notice they're very widely spaced. They're spaced far apart. So they really can be used for filter feeding because they just don't match up. They're too far apart from one another. Anything, if you close the mouth, the teeth would be so far apart, anything in there would scoot out between them. And there's some evidence in the roof of the mouth of vascularization, so blood vessels that would feed the gums that would grow baleen. So it's suggested that perhaps these guys had teeth and baleen. And so the teeth weren't being used for much, but this new structure, the baleen, was around in these Ediacetids, and they used it to filter feed, and then the teeth eventually became useless. And this, I think, is the earliest toothless mysticete. And if you look, this is the skull and dorsal and ventral views, and it looks pretty much like an Ediacetid, but there are no teeth. And that makes sense, right? At some point, the teeth wouldn't be needed anymore, and they could just go away and keep the baleen. Now, the skull is still being prepared, and we're looking for evidence of that vascularization I talked about. And my grad student is literally doing this like right now. So he's working on it. This is a specimen at the Smithsonian. And so he's working on it to see if it really is. I know when it came from. It's from the early Oligocene. And we're looking to make sure it doesn't have teeth and see if there's any evidence of that vascularization for baleen. Okay, so now we're going to skip back. So we got all the way to a vaguely modern baleen whale, one without teeth. Now we're going to skip back and look at odontocetes. So I know you can't read this. Don't have to worry about it. I'll tell you what you need to know. So this whole group here are ones from the Oligocene. And if you look, there's one little group here, which is the earliest branch. And I'll tell you about those. And then there's a whole bunch of stuff here, and then more modern things. So we're going to look in this group here and see what the earliest odontocetes were like. So that first branch that I showed you on the tree is this group, the Xenorhophidae, and it's based on a specimen that actually came from South Carolina, the Oligocene. There's a whole lot of Oligocene deposits this age around Charleston, and they're really quite rich. And so that one, the earliest one that was described was by this guy from California, I mentioned, and he described it from Charleston. This one came from a really interesting place off the coast of North Carolina, where there are rocks with fossils under the water. So when storms pick up, they knock off pieces of rock and throw them up on the beach, and people find them in the rocks on the beach. And so this one got brought to the Smithsonian, prepped it out, and turned out to be Zygorhiza that I described back in 2008. This is another closely related thing called this called Cymocetus. The Zygorhizas are only known from South Carolina, North Carolina, and Cymocetus is only known from the Pacific Northwest. So that one's from Oregon, and it's one of these early toothed whales as well. And you can see that here's the nose, right there's the nose, and it's moving further back in the skull. And we have good evidence in the ears and the structures of the face that not only could they make high frequency sounds, but they could also perceive them. And so it's pretty clear that these very earliest odontocetes could echolocate, and they used that system to find their prey. And these guys are also much smaller than the latest basilosaurus, the latest archaeocetes. So they're a little smaller, and they can echolocate to find their prey. Right, so this is my last group of early odontocetes. This one's called the Agarotheidae. And this has got a great story. This is another one from South Carolina. And this specimen was described by True in 1908. But the problem is the specimen itself is lost. It's missing. And the only thing we have left of it is this tooth, which is in the museum at Harvard, the Museum of Comparative Zoology, and this print, this picture of it. And so it makes it really hard to compare it to other things because we don't actually have the specimen. But my buddy Stephen Godfrey and I have this thing from South Carolina, and we think it's the same animal based on what we can see in the picture. And so we're writing a paper on it right now. Actually, there's an analysis running through my computer right now to figure out how it's related to other things. Hopefully it'll be done by the time we get home. But we're going to publish this as a new specimen of Agarotheus. And so those are all the different kinds of things that make up that early diversification of odontocetes. Oh, I lied. Here's one more slide. So there's also these guys, the white patids, were first described in New Zealand. And these guys are the first ones that we know for sure, have this feature we call polydont. And one feature that dolphins have today is they have a lot of teeth. They have more teeth than an animal should have. And Wypatia here has got way lots of teeth. So it's got a long snout and more teeth. And that's true also of this group called the Squalodontidae. And it's really well represented in the Calvert Formation on the east coast of North America and Virginia and Maryland. Has everyone been to Calvert Cliffs? No, you get up there, it's really neat, and you go collect fossils and shark's teeth, and you might find some of these. And what's interesting about this is that, look at these teeth, don't they look familiar? They got two roots, they got a triangular shape, they got little bumps on them. They look basically like little archaeocete teeth. There's nothing new or innovative about them, but their skulls are actually pretty advanced. Here's the nares right there. It's way up on top of the head. So his skull's gotten long, the nose has moved, and they still got these old-fashioned teeth. Because today, modern dolphins and killer whales and sperm whales have teeth with single roots, and they have none of this fancy denticles on. I think that's my last slide about these early odontocetes. Okay, so now onto the last phase of whale evolution, where we're going to take those early representatives of these groups and evolve modern forms from them. So this is the next time period forward, the Miocene, and this is representative about 20 million years ago. And again, we've got cold polar waters and warm tropical waters, and the dots represent mysticetes and odontocetes. We find them basically all over the world, which is good, because whales, basically, if they can, they can basically swim anywhere. So there's very few barriers to their distribution around the world. And if you look here, These are all the mysticetes and all the odontocetes, but the light colors represent families of them that are extinct, and the dark colors represent families of them that are still around. And notice that all the ones that show up early in the Oligocene, even the late Oligocene, most of them are gone. They are no longer around. Only one, the Physeteris, the sperm whales, makes it all the way from the Oligocene to the recent. And I don't even believe that. That is one fossil anchoring it there, and I think it's just not. It's a piece of junk. It's terrible. I've seen it. It's in the Republic of Georgia, the other Georgia. And I went all the way there to see it, because the reports of it were terrible, and the pictures of it were terrible. And when I got there, I was like, oh, they're not just bad pictures, it's a bad fossil. Anyway, so the whole point of this slide is to show you that all this archaic stuff goes away, and then we get the origin of modern things during the Miocene that still are around today. So the Miocene is the time when all the modern whale families originate. So we're going to look at baleen whales again first, and this is the first. We actually have fossil baleen. I told you it didn't fossilize well, but it didn't take any fossilize at all. It fossilizes poorly, but there is fossil baleen. It's like fossilizing your finger, right? It doesn't have to take very special conditions. But this is, I took this picture in Peru, and this is the palate up here, that's the roof of the mouth, and the lower jaw is down here, and these are the plates of baleen. It comes like sort of like a stack of paper. And I could count all the plates, there's 142, which is sort of it's a okay number for this group of baleenopterids, which are the really big baleen whales around today. Pretty cool. So we actually have not just vascular structures, no, we have actual fossilized baleen. It exists in the Miocene. We also have stuff like this. We have a big flat palate on this skull. This is the skull, and it's a drawing of it in the Smithsonian. And see these grooves? Those are the vascular grooves I was telling you about. So we have things that have no teeth and the vascular grooves that are associated with the baleen. And there's plenty of these. This is from, again, the Calvert Formation in Maryland. We have lots of them all over the world. This is one called Parabalanoptera. This is from California. This is the skull, and this is a reconstruction of it. I just thought it was a really great fossil that I'll show it to you. And you can see, here's how flat the palate is. This is typical of the largest baleen whales around today. Very flat skull, short baleen. And these guys can take their jaw and open it to about 90 degrees and engulf a huge volume of water. And then what they do is they squeeze the water out through the baleen, and the krill gets stuck on the inside and lick it off their tongue and eat it. That's not how all baleen whales feed, but that's how baleenopterids feed. This is Myocaparia. There is a thing called the pygmy right whale around today, and it's called Caparia. This is the Miocene version of Caparia. This is the only fossil of this whole family that we have ever. It's from Peru. And Caparia today is restricted to the southern hemisphere. Ooh, where's Peru? Southern hemisphere. So it makes sense that it would be found there. It's a very unusual animal, but Myocaparia looks basically like modern Caparia. It's very little different between the two. Okay, so here's a couple more from Georgia. This one is from the Pleistocene, which is the Ice Age, just not too long ago, maybe about 10,000 years ago. And over here is a picture of the back of the jaw of the gray whale, Ischrichthyes. And this fossil is dredged up over here off the coast of Georgia. And this is it. And it's a pretty good match to gray whale Ischrichthyes. But here's what's weird about that. There are no gray whales in the Atlantic Ocean today. Where do you find them? The Pacific. You can go to California, you go whale watching, you're going to look for gray whales migrating up and down the coast. But get this, gray whales, you know why there are no gray whales in the North Atlantic? Huh? We killed them all in prehistoric, not quite prehistoric, but sort of, you know the Basques? They're sort of living in the sort of France-Spain border area. They are very good whalers. And they have been whaling the North Atlantic for a long time. It's not that basically Basque hunters killed every single last one of them in North America, well, in the North Atlantic. And there's evidence from millions, like piles of bones of gray whales in the Atlantic that were clearly processed by humans. And maybe not just the Basque, but Vikings did this and the whales. And basically, we hunted this group to extinction in the North Atlantic. So could they come back here? They might. I mean, they did okay in the past. So if they ever get over here, they might be able to thrive. But the reason they're not here now is because humans hunted them to extinction in this region. Okay, so here are the modern groups that we have. Cape Parry, I mentioned, that's the pygmy right whale. These are the right whales. And these guys don't have a flat palate, but they have a big arched palate, really long baleen. These guys feed differently. They have a gap in the front. And they go around what's called skimming, with their mouth open, and water goes in and out the sides, and they skim stuff out of the water. And you know why they call them right whales? This is a good one, too. They're the right ones to kill. And you know why? Because they float when they're dead. And these guys are more like the density of water, and if they sink, you lose it, right? These guys always float. And so that's why they're the right whales. And they're also at extremely low numbers in the North Atlantic because of all the hunting. And the real issue with them today is ship strikes. There are so many ships going from Europe to North America that they hit the whales on their way through and kill them. The ships are so big, kill them. So it's a big issue. Okay, so now we'll do the odontocetes, and then we'll wrap it up. So in the Miocene, we have groups like this, the Urhinodelphinids, which are really unusual in that they have a super duper long snout. And in fact, if you look at it, it's much longer than the lower jaw. And so there's this edentulous, this portion has no teeth, sticking out in the front. And these guys were really common across Europe and North America and elsewhere in the world. And they were very diverse too. There were lots of different kinds, and there were lots of them. And it's not really clear why. They may have been out-competed by diversification of this group. The Kentriodontidae are the earliest of the delphinids. Delphinids are dolphins, porpoises, and things like belugas and white whales. So this group started to diversify from things like this, which look, in the Miocene, for all intents and purposes, like a modern dolphin. There's some very sort of fussy and tangential details which set them apart, but they look very much like modern dolphins. And these guys diversify, these guys go extinct. Here's an example of the modern porpoise group that just got described by my colleague Rachel Rasico from the Pliocene of California. And you know what I just showed you? You were in a delphinids had a long snout and a short jaw. These guys have the reverse. They have a really long jaw and a short snout, so their jaw sticks out way further than their nose, than the snout does. Again, what are they doing? I don't know. She suggested that maybe they were probing the sediment for flatfish, things that were living on the bottom. But she did a really interesting study. She CT scanned the skulls and looked at air spaces in the head and all kinds of neat stuff. So we're making these discoveries constantly. We're discovering new things at a high rate, so we're still exploring this whole space. This is a fossil example of one of the monodontids, narwhals and belugas. This is a fossil one from North Carolina. So here's a beluga, here's a narwhal. You know what that is? What's that thing? It's the narwhal tusk. It's a tooth. It's one tooth. And belugas don't have them, and Bohastia doesn't have them. This is actually named after the collections manager at the Smithsonian, famous Dave Bohaska. And he found it and he did that. But this is a fossil relative of these modern guys that are exclusively Northern Hemisphere. And this is farther south. North Carolina is much farther south than either of the distributions of these guys. And this is my last nod to Georgia. You don't have a whole lot of fossil whales in more recent times, but this is one of them, discovered near Savannah. It's called Anoplanasa forsythata. And it's a representative of the second most diverse group of toothed whales called the Ziphii, or the beaked whales. And a lot of people aren't familiar with them because they don't tend to hang out near shore. They tend to hang out in the open ocean. But they're deep divers that tend to eat squid. They usually have either none or a very low number of teeth. And so this is the snout of one, and it's got two sockets here for teeth. So that's the actual fossil that's sitting drawing of it. And it's in the Academy of Natural Sciences in Philadelphia, but the description is described a long time ago in the 19th century, and the description of the place it was found was near Savannah, which is pretty vague, but that's all I got. We think it's Pleistocene, but we don't know. So if you're ever near Savannah, keep your eye out. We need more fossil to describe this better. Okay, so these are the modern families of odontocetes. The sperm whales and their relatives are the oldest branch, so they're the most primitive, the most earliest branch. We've got platanistoids, which are these river dolphin-y things, the white whales and belugas, like I mentioned, beaked whales, dolphins, and porpoises. So by the end of the Miocene, all these things were around, and they're what we see today. Okay, so just sort of wrap things up. I'm showing you a map here of all the fossil cetaceans in the world. And one of the leaders of this project called the Paleobiology Database, where our goal is to database every fossil on the planet. And we're doing it one little bit at a time. And I've done all the marine mammals, and it's all publicly accessible. You can make this map if you go to our website, which I probably should put up here. It's just Google Paleobiology Database. We'll pop right up. And so you can actually make these maps. You just tell it what you want to see and what time period you want to see it from, and it'll actually move the continents to the positions they were during that time period. So you can see how the distribution has changed over time. And it's pretty cool. And a lot of the data I've been showing you comes from this database. And I'm going to show you one last thing that I learned from doing this, which is I'm very interested in diversity and what causes different groups to be more diverse or less diverse. To have more different kinds of things or less different kinds of things. So I made this graph. Here's all the time periods that whales exist in. And the bar, the width of the bar represents the number of different kinds of whales, number of different genera in those time periods. And you look, it starts out low, because of course there's a single origin, so it starts out low, gets pretty big, and then crashes towards the Eocene-Oligocene boundary, which is what happened then? That's when the entire global oceanic circulation changed from what it was to what it is today. You think that would have an effect on diversity of marine creatures? I think so. It did. There it is. Then the modern whales diversify up till the middle Miocene when it's huge. It's like 2 to 3 times what it is today. And this is a time period. I should probably hit the other slide, which actually has labels on them. That's a climate minimum. That's when it got cold. This is when it got optimum. That's called the mid-Miocene climatic optimum. They're very literal people. So it's in the middle of the Miocene and it's nice. That's what we call it. And then this is a little problem when sea level falls and the Mediterranean dries up. And there's a lot of fossils from around the Mediterranean, so that's actually a sampling problem. But if you ignore that, it just sort of drops towards today. So as the climate deteriorates towards the Ice Age, which we're technically still in, we get less whale diversity. And so I did a study with a colleague of mine, and we found that climate and ocean productivity are the two things that seem to drive diversity. And that makes lots of sense. Productivity is linked to their food source. And climate, you can all understand that being a driver for the number of kinds of things. Where is things most diverse today? In the tropics. And for whales, most diversity happens at mid-latitudes. It's not the warm water, it's the sort of temperate waters that are best for them. So when it's too hot or too cold, we don't have much mid-latitudes, and so we don't get many whales. And so we see it too cold, gets pretty, this is not the warmest time, but it's a time we got a lot of sort of temperate regions, and then it gets too cold. Okay, and so we think those two things together really drive diversity, and that's what we see creating this pattern. And that's all I got. So I hope you enjoyed it. I hope you learned something. And if you have any questions, I am here to help out. So now is the time to ask. Thank you very much. questions?
I don't believe you.
Yes.
Can I get you to go like maybe 4 or 5 slides back? Where do they have the modern whales? That one right there.
Okay.
So it seems like evolution is selecting for these extremely like hydrodynamic shapes.
Oh yeah.
But then if you look in the upper left-hand corner, it seemed like evolution said, screw it, let's make a square whale.
All right, so.
Do you have any theories of why?
You have pointed out one of the weirdest things about these animals ever. So sperm whales have this, if you strip them down to the bone, they have a similarly shaped head, except there's this huge dish, and they have this extra thing there called the serratus organ, and it's full of stuff that's called literally junk, right? And that's why they killed Moby Dick, right? That's why they hunted sperm whales, was for the serratus. And honestly, nobody really knows what it's there for. Like, it's this giant thing on the head, and people have thoughts, but none of them have really come out as the winner, you know, about why it even exists.
What is the junk made
out of? It's just this fatty goo. It's protein and fat and water. But seriously, it's one of the big unanswered questions about sperm whales. What is this huge organ for? What they do, what these guys do, they're very big. They're the biggest of the odontocetes. And they dive very deep and eat giant squid. So one wants to think, has something to do with an alteration of their echolocation system? Or maybe it helps them deal with a really incredible pressure down there? But I don't know. But it's a great question. All right, what else we got? No more? Really answered all your questions?
Weren't the sperm whales hunted for that spermaceti because it was used, known as whale oil and used to feed the lambs of the world at the time?
Yep, that's true, but we don't know what the whales wanted it for, what they used it for. Yep. And whales were hunted for all kinds of reasons, for their oil or meat. They used to use the baleen in situations where you use plastic now because it's sort of flexible, but it springs back into shape. Yeah, there's a question down here in front. What you got?
Why is the delphinus white? Is it really white?
This one?
The delphin?
This one, Delphinapterus. Yep, they're really that color.
Okay.
They're called white whales. And they live in Arctic environments. So they sort of match. They like to hang out near the edge of sea ice. So I don't know, maybe it's to help them hide the cryptic coloration against the snow or something. And you see a lot of these guys have a white belly and a dark top.
They probably are around the Arctic.
Well,
but around the sea at the same time.
You know what? You know why they're white on the bottom and dark on the top? That helps hide them. If you're a killer whale and you're looking up, the sky is bright. And so if you're white on the belly, it helps hide you. But it also helps hide you if anything looking down from the top, you're looking dark against the water. And so a lot of small odontocetes have this counter shading where they're white on the bottom and dark on the top. Even killer whales do. They're black on the top and white on the bottom. Great point. Yes?
Talk about bone density early in the slides.
Mm-hmm.
Do you see, at what point do you see that kind of just level out?
Some of the archaeocetes have pretty dense bone, and then after that, with the origin of mysticetes or odontocetes, their bones get pretty light. They sort of adopt different ways of weighting themselves. And most whales are about neutrally buoyant in water. Like I said, the white whales tend to float and some tend to sink, but they're all pretty close to the density of water. And what's really interesting is, you know, I said these guys are deep divers. What do you do when you dive? What do you do? Free water. Why don't you want to do that if you're going to 2,000 meters? Well, it's worse than that. What do divers get to come up to that? They get the bends. And what happens is nitrogen in the air gets into your bloodstream, dissolves in your bloodstream, and then you come up, it forms bubbles. And that's bad, because it clogs into your arteries and you die. And so whales, instead of inhaling, they actually exhale, and they actually collapse their entire their entire respiratory system. They actually squish it down like a balloon to nothing. And they store oxygen in their muscles and their blood. They have way more hemoglobin, They have way more, a similar molecule called myoglobin in their muscles. Their muscles are really dark red because they pump oxygen into the muscles and take it down with them. But they don't take air down, because if they did, it would dissolve in the blood and make it the veins, and that would be bad. So it's really amazing adaptation for diving. Really special. Yeah. Yes?
What do you think caused whales, or the earliest whale ancestors, to go back into the water?
This is
the second transition.
So this is tricky. Answering the question why. We can document what happened. Yeah, so I have ideas, of course. It looks like they went into the water to feed. The earliest things we see changing are their sensory systems, so their ears, and their feeding apparatus. So I think they were in the water feeding, and then they kept adapting more and more to being in the water, because the more time you can spend there, the more time you can feed there. And we think, I didn't bring a slide of this, but I probably should have. We think the last life activity that they did on land was breeding. And if you look at modern pinnipeds, seals, sea lions, and walruses, there are other marine mammals, they still come on the land to do one thing, and that's to reproduce and to have their babies. And there's a specimen of one of these protocetids from Pakistan that has a near-term fetus. So it's clearly female, the fetus in it. And today, when think of like a gazelle, you see in all these nature videos, right? And a gazelle having a baby, which end comes out first? Or a cow, or sheep, or animals? The head or the tail?
The head.
The head. You know what comes out first in whales? The tail. Why? Huh? It's really important. You don't want it to drown. If the head comes out first, the baby goes, it's going to drown. And you don't want that. If the baby gets stuck on the way out, takes a breath, it would drown. And so they come out tail first. So whales are already dactyls, but they do birth in reverse. So when they found the fetus, it was in the artiodactyl position to come out head first. And so the guy who described it, my former advisor, Phil Gaynor, said, look, it was still having birth on land because it's got the terrestrial position of the fetus. I'm like, well, that's really clever. I never thought we'd have data to answer that question. Is it for sure? No, it's a pretty good idea, and I think he's right. And so that was probably the last activity they were still doing on land. Yep. What else? Yes?
Can you go back to our screen of our little Ziggy?
Almost there. That one? We can go out there and you can take pictures too. Although I was in a ladder. You can't get this picture. I was in a ladder. So. There was somebody else right there. Yes?
You have danced around the whole subject all night about the closeness between the anatomy of all these fellas and all us fellas, but you've not tried connecting them in any way.
I can't. The easiest thing to say is we're all mammals. And in fact, we're all vertebrates, and all vertebrates have basically the same bones.
So are you thinking that we've evolved even further back to?
No. The similarities we have in common is we inherited from common ancestors with these guys. So 70 million years ago, there was a common ancestor of all whales, all artiodactyls, us, all the primates, all the cameras you got here, common ancestor, and they had the same bones we have. It's just, like, these guys lost legs over time. We didn't, we kept them. But the common ancestor had the legs. And we have, you know, if you look inside like a whale flipper, they have five fingers. They still got them today, we still got five fingers. So it's all inherited from the common ancestor. Yep, good question. Yep?
From the early transitional whales,
are you eating
those fossils
now? You mean like whale footprints? Wouldn't that be cool? No. But I got a great whale trace fossil for you. They just last year described in the paper whale fossil ambergris, which is basically sperm whale barf. Which I was like, wow, that's pretty big. What are these guys doing? Take a little pause.
say it was a sperm whale?
It's basically sperm whale bark.
Oh,
ambergris. They use it to make perfume because it stinks. I don't know. Look it up. It's the craziest thing. Yeah?
Ziggy out here. The dark material is added from the addition, and the black material is the original?
Yes. So this is cast, this is original. And that one tooth there is also a replacement that was missing. Yep, and there's a couple, that one, and there's another one right here. That one may be the other replacement. Yep, I read all the notes, actually, of the preparator today.
Oh, you did see them?
I read them all. It's very interesting. And he most of the replacement parts, like your skeleton, is about 50% complete, were cast from things at Smithsonian.
Yeah,
you
can do that.
Mm-hmm.
If I could interrupt, just not to stop questions, but I just wanted to recognize, and I'm sorry so many people got away before it. Our Ziggy the Dorudon was discovered by Mr. Bill Christie, and his grandson is here with us with his family tonight, and I just wanted to thank you.
Sorry.
Carl Joyce is the chief geologist at Caden Minerals, which was originally the mines that Cuba, where it was found.
Absolutely. All sorts of great stuff. I'm glad you guys are here.
Yes.
On your slide of the early Mysticetes, you had a little early one, and I know a lot of people here haven't heard of what they call the Wando whale. Is that representative of that Wando whale?
No. Which one are you looking for? I'm not sure which one you're looking for. Which slide?
It's the early where you have the Mysticetes with all the lines. Here.
This one?
No,
I know what you mean.
No,
Yeah. No, I don't think so.
That right there.
No.
Oh, yeah. Is CM or CHM Charleston Museum team? Is that Wando whale?
It is not.
I haven't described yet.
Nope. No, it's much more recent.
More recent than that.
Yeah.
Even though it has all those teeth in its mouth.
I know which one you're talking about. It's one of those. It's not that one, but it's down in this room. Yeah. Yes, there's a bunch of stuff in Charleston that have big teeth.
They've got one in that museum, the Mace Brown Museum, with all those teeth, and they think that they did what you were talking about earlier, close their mouth and filter.
Yeah. Those are, if I had a wish list for things to get done, that would be tough.
Get
for someone to get those described.
Get that thing described.
Yeah, yes, sir.
Back in 2008, I had the privilege of visiting a mine on the West Coast in Lombok.
Oh, yeah.
Diatomaceous earth. When I was there, they had uncovered part of the skeleton of a whale at the time. I could see the dorsal fin and part of the skull. And they were trying to get it out at that time. Do you know any more about what happened there?
Lombok has produced all kinds of crazy stuff. Pinheads, whales. I think there's even some serenians from there. It's diatomaceous earth is what they're mining there. So I'm not sure exactly which specimen you're talking about, but I know there have been some really big things that come out of there that have yet to be described. And there's a lot of stuff sitting in the LA County Museum and the one in Orange County and San Bernardino County. There's like a ton of things out there we have waiting to be described. There's maybe five or six of us on the planet who like study these things, and so we're trying, but there's a lot to do. Yeah. I've never been to Lombok, but I heard it's pretty amazing.
Others?
Yes, sir.
You had a slide there that you showed of a section where you said that it was fossil preserved of baleen.
Yep.
There. That reminded me, its appearance reminded me of fossils I've collected of ray dentitions.
I know what you mean. I've seen them, I've collected them. It's superficial. So what you're looking at here is the baleen from the side. So each of those lines represents a plane going this way and sort of chopped in half. Whereas those ray teeth are individual dental elements together.
And they would be like top and bottom.
Right, they form a pavement, they form a surface. They're like tiles.
And you're saying this is from the side?
Yeah, this is the side.
Okay,
it's like a vertebrae.
Yeah, sort of like a loaf of bread from the side.
Yeah.
Okay. Anyone else? Well, thank you all for coming. If you want, we can walk out and look at the specimen. There's a cast of the jaw here. You can come take a look at it a little closer up. But thank you all for coming. I really appreciate you inviting me down.
Talk a little bit about yourself. Tell us what you do.
Sure. I'm Dr. Mark Uhen, and I am from George Mason University in Fairfax, Virginia, and I study mainly fossil whales and whale evolution.
And how long have you been studying that?
I got my doctoral degree in 1996, so since then, and I've been at George Mason for the past 7 years.
Can you tell us a little bit about our Ziggy fossil and how exactly that you chose to reclassify him? What did you see?
Sure. I'm an expert on the group of whales that your Ziggy is from, and I tried to come here to see it many years ago, and it didn't work out, in part because it was hanging from the ceiling. It was hard to get at, and I was really pleased when the museum asked me to come down and take a look at it and talk about it a little bit, and I had suspected just from photos that it was probably a different genus that it had been classified in. It used to be called Zygorhiza, and looking at it more closely, I've decided it belongs in a genus called Dorudon, and they're very closely related, but the features it shows clearly show that it's Dorudon and not Zygorhiza.
Okay, great. A little bit of an unrelated question, but what do you find is the importance of museums in our society and for our kids?
Well, in particular, science museums and natural history museums, I think, are really important because kids, when they're really young, are basically natural scientists. Science is the study of the natural world, and kids have to discover everything about their world, and so they poke and prod and look and smell and taste everything. And that's basically what scientists do, just in a more sophisticated way. And so I think it's really, really important to keep that interest in learning things and learning things about the natural world in kids, and I think museums do that, and they also are extremely appealing to adults who want to keep learning in their whole lives.
Here at this particular museum, we have an initiative called STEA+M, which is basically integrating the sciences and the arts together. Have you heard about this initiative, and what do you think about it?
I have, and I actually used to work at a place called the Cranbrook Institute of Science, and on the campus we also had an art museum, so we had a very similar theme in that we often tried to work with the art museum and tried to integrate science and art together, and I think there are many ways that they are very complementary to one another. In fact, I had a student in one of my classes, my vertebrate paleontology class, who was an artist. He was an art major, and he wanted to work on museum exhibits, so he took a minor in paleontology, and I actually hired him to do exhibitry for me at George Mason. It worked out really, really well.
Okay, great. Did you get the chance to look around the museum today, and kind of what did you think about it?
I have, and I think it's a really interesting amalgam of science and the sort of mini zoo, and of course the whale fossils are my favorite, but I think it's a really wonderful place, and I hope everyone gets a chance to visit.